Good afternoon, Austin, and welcome back. It's us. The Atheist Experience is on, and we are live June 23rd, 2002. I'm your host, Martin Wagner. Ashley Perrien is my co-host today.
Afternoon, everybody.
And thank you for joining us on another hot, sweltery Sunday afternoon in the summer in Texas. This show is sponsored by Atheist Community of Austin. We are a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. This is a live call-in program. We're here 4:30 every afternoon on Sundays, and reruns of this show now run at 4:30 p.m. on Tuesday afternoons. The ACA holds weekly meetings every Sunday morning at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop, located at 307 West 5th Street. That's downtown on 5th Street between Guadalupe and Lavaca, except for the first Sunday of each month when we hold our lecture series at 11 a.m. in the Longhorn Room of First Cafeteria in North Cross Mall. Our next lecture, I believe, will be the 7th of July, is the first Sunday of July, and our speaker will be the outreach director for the Texas Freedom Network, which is a civil liberties sort of watchdog organization operating here in Texas. And I think the main topic of discussion will have to do with the what looks like it's about to become an upcoming slugfest over the content of textbooks, which the fundamentalist Christians want to sort of neuter the textbooks. And render them into little indoctrination pamphlets, apparently. So, and there's an effort to stop that.
Yes.
So that's coming up on the 7th. Other ACA events include Godless Gamers, which now takes place Monday nights at 7 p.m. at the home of Russell and Virginia Glasser. For information on how to get there, contact Russell or Ginny in the group. Russell's not here today. Shame. But
Get on the gamers email list.
Yeah, that's true.
Link from our website. Russell's ask for directions there.
Yeah, Russell's a new dad, so he's a busy fellow now. But we have our gamers mailing list at accessible and joinable via our website. URL is right there. Also, ACA Happy Hour takes place Thursday evenings about 7:30, 8-ish or so at Antonio's Tex-Mex. Near the intersection of I-35 and Highway 183. That's a fun sort of evening get-together for folks who can't make the morning things. The Nonprofits is another media outreach of ours. It's a radio show on the internet sponsored by ACA and hosted by Jeff D. and co-hosted by Mary McManamy and Vic Farrow. And that plays Saturday afternoons at 2 at the atheistnetwork.com website. Your browser will need to have the real audio, the real player plugin, excuse me, to hear the audio stream, and there is a live chat room feature that you can use to interact with the program while it's going on, and that's always a ton of fun to listen to. So give that a listen Saturday afternoons. Tongue's getting tied. The Godless Americans March on Washington is tentatively slated for November the 2nd. That's a Saturday coming up later this year. Of course, plans like this could always change. Apparently every other little special interest group, from the African Americans to the Promise Keepers to women to who else, to gays and lesbians, they've done their little march up the Washington Mall, and now the American Atheists organization is saying, hey, it's time for Godless Americans to do one. So that's being tentatively planned for November the 2nd, and you can find out more information about this event at godlessamericans.org. website, and Atheist Community of Austin is not affiliated with American Atheists in any way. But sometimes they do cool stuff that we think is all right. Okay, so that's what's going on. That's who we are. That's for more information on us, you can visit our lovely website at atheist-community.org or call our voicemail 371-2911 for more information. And it's over to Ashley for today's news.
Okay.
How you doing, Ashley?
Doing quite well.
Good.
A little light on the news side today, but it's got some good stuff anyway. Yeah, hopefully we'll get to it through a vast majority of it. First one, just to start off with something lighthearted and fun.
Okay.
Which, unfortunately, it shouldn't be.
Well, but it's hard not to.
Yeah. Well,
preacher said he was dragged, beat up after sermon.
Oh.
Locksley, Alabama. Authorities are investigating an alleged beating of a preacher by funeral mourners who didn't like his blunt eulogy. Glynis Bethel tells the Associated Press that her husband, Pastor Orlando Bethel, was attacked during a June 14 funeral and dragged out of the church. That's because Bethel told mourners the deceased was in hell and that they were headed the same way.
Okay.
The dead man was Miss Bethel's uncle. Pastor Bethel referred to him as a drunkard and a fornicator. Miss Bethel, who's also a preacher, says the fornicators didn't like what he said, so they got up and beat him. She says police didn't make any arrests, so she and her husband, who may have a broken nose, are taking out warrants. It's always bad when somebody gets hurt, but this is just funny.
comedy of, some definite family issues going on there. Yeah.
Yes, apparently, and since he was saying that...
No love lost between the preacher and the dead guy, for sure.
Or his wife.
Or his...
Who was... The dead guy was her uncle.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah, there are definitely some family problems. Sounds like the preacher was also a drunkard.
Or just a moron. Yeah.
Hey, oh, well. Go to hell, the drunkard and the fornicator.
That's just plain stupidity. It's not as nearly as tasteless as, like, Fred Phelps and his gang of homophobes.
Yes.
Staging protests and holding up nasty signs at the funerals of gay men.
Absolutely.
But it's still, there's a similar insensitivity there.
Yeah, you got to be a little bit careful.
But it sounds to me like there's something personal going on. There's a little soap opera happening that we don't
There's know. A lot more behind the scenes that we didn't get to.
Well, yeah,
apparently.
Well, he won't do that again.
Who knows? Okay, this one is
actually... On to real news now.
Yes. I have been kind of trying to steer clear of some of the sexual abuse stuff of the Catholic Church, simply because we've gone over it quite a few times.
Yeah.
If you listen to the radio show, we go, it's on there all the, pretty often.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm just trying to steer clear. But this is one that I didn't want to avoid. This was a good one. Catholics lift secrecy veil on sex abuse. The Catholic Church in New Zealand has revealed that 38 confirmed cases of sexual abuse have been committed by men in its ranks. They also admitted that their previous way of dealing with offenders was wrong. Church authorities said that under new policies, they would remove any known pedophiles from public ministry and strongly recommend victims to take criminal complaints to the police. The step towards openness, which the church's dark secrets are also reflected in the new stance and confidentiality clauses, which prohibit revealing details of settlements. As condemnation of secret settlements grows, the St. John of God Brothers said that they have ordered lawyers to remove confidentiality clauses from deals worth $300,000 already made with five victims, and to ensure future agreements do not have them.
Really?
Yeah, so they're even telling that, we'll settle for $100,000 and it's not secret.
Well, that's, certainly seems to be a bit more of a responsible stance than what we got here in America.
Yes.
Where they said, okay, we'll smack these guys down, we will, remove them from their positions and kick them out of,
their position of authority.
But in the States, what they said was, we won't actually kick them out of the church. They'll still get to be priests, even though they won't work as priests. They can't be in anywhere, but they'll still be in the church. And it's kind of an attempt, seems like the American, which the Vatican hasn't signed off on yet, to my knowledge, but the American meeting of bishops that happened in Dallas was a thing where it was like trying to have it both ways. And a lot of people, were, I think, rightly cynical about, we'll punish them, but, we won't go so far as to kick them out of the clergy.
Yeah,
they just won't be able to work as priests. They won't be able to be anywhere near a parish.
And even that was a heavy question.
Yeah, but they'll still get to, collect their pensions or whatever. And there's kind of something's, just not quite wrong with it. Just kick the SOBs out.
These New Zealanders seem to be taking a pretty hard line, which is a good thing.
Which is better. I mean, it's
definitely.
Yeah, it's better.
So there was a tendency in the past to protect the institution or the profession.
Yeah.
The recidivist nature of the psychosexual dysfunction or pedophilia was not understood, and it was thought that if a person admitted guilt, confessed it, and was given absolution in the sacrament of confession, rehabilitation and forgiveness was possible. We now know that kind of sexual abuse is addictive and has to be treated appropriately, and the person must be removed from any opportunity to reoffend. Even one person hurt is too many. In the past, when leaders of the church were faced with a case of abuse or misconduct, we made mistakes. Some mistakes were serious. And we look back now, with the benefit of hindsight, we find it hard to understand why we sometimes made decisions such as geographical cure and do not believe moving an offender helped anyone.
Do anything, yeah. More.
So.
Well, it sounds like they're making a better attempt at accountability than they did here in the States. But what's interesting, though, is that this is where? This is New Zealand, right?
Yes, yes.
So this is clearly turning into a global problem.
Oh, yeah.
And this is further egg on the face of the Vatican, who early on, and when all of this whole scandal was unfolding, made the extremely unwise, from a PR standpoint, move of trying to say, oh, this is just America's liberal, permissive attitude.
Oh, yeah.
That
yeah.
to blame it. It's
MTV's fault.
Yeah, obviously there's this climate of permissiveness that I guess poisoned the otherwise pure minds of these priests, and that's what made them do this bad stuff.
Yeah.
No, obviously, if this is going on in places like New Zealand and many other countries in the world, this is a problem for priests. Are pedophiles being attracted to the priesthood? And I thought about this many times, and it seems to be, you think about, well, why would so many pedophiles be flocking to the priesthood? And I remember Mary on one of the radio shows pointed out, well, because it's a protected environment.
Yeah.
It seems to be the one place that pedophiles can go where they will have access to kids, and that there is also a system in place designed to hush this stuff up and not really punish these guys for what they're doing. Yeah. And I guess they know that. So this is certainly speculative to a certain point, but it's clearly a global problem. I think that recently there was reported on the radio show that one, and we may have talked about it here, I don't know, but wasn't it found that there was a priest in Florida who was at least accused of running some sort of pedo prostitution ring that provided kids for visiting
sent missionaries
church
or whatever.
From the Vatican, from Europe. They'd come over here on their doing their work for the church.
God.
And there was something set up for those guys. I mean,
that is so sick and twisted.
It's true, beyond sick. I said I have to get that
that
story
from weeks back.
That was at least three four weeks back, but still, shocking. But this whole attempt to sort of shift blame, oh, it's society's fault.
Yeah.
Oh, it's the kids' fault for not reporting.
Yeah, I know.
What's that about? At least the New Zealanders seem to be looking at the mistakes that the American
taking note of
church
our mistakes
and saying, oops,
let's not do that.
Yeah, let's just deal with this now and do it up front, and so it's a little better.
Yeah, yeah.
So
offenders are now sent for treatment in Australia and removed from public ministry upon their return.
Yeah, well.
So good for New Zealand.
Yeah, yeah. But the church is forever blemished by this, and although it's a shame. I'm sure that there are still millions of priests out there who are really nice guys.
Oh, of course.
And it's a shame that they are now getting the backwash of suspense and suspicion.
Yeah.
On account of this, but I think that it's nothing but a good thing that the Catholic Church itself is hurting. I mean, the Catholic Church has hurt the human race, been hurting it for the past 1,000 years.
Yeah.
It's time that maybe just something happened to send the whole house of cards.
Yeah, it's just unfortunate it had to happen at the
expense of kids.
At the expense of kids. Yeah,
yeah. It's so. Drastic.
Oh well.
Oh well.
Away from that stuff.
Yeah. So cheer us up,
Ashley. Well, then I should skip that one.
Okay. No, read it all. We still got a few minutes to kill.
Okay. Islamic bloc, Christian right, team up to lobby the UN.
That's weird.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Talk about strange bedfellows. Mm. Conservative U.S. Christian organizations have joined forces with Islamic governments to halt the expansion of sexual and political protections and rights for gays, women, and children at the United Nations conference. The new alliance, which coalesced during the past year, has received a major boost from the Bush administration, which appointed anti-abortion activists to key position in U.S. delegations to the U.N. conferences on global economic and social policy. The Alliance of Conservative Islamic States and Christian Organizations has placed the Bush administration in the awkward position of siding with some of its most reviled adversaries, including Iraq and Iran, in a cultural skirmish against its closest European allies, which broadly support expanding sexual and political rights.
Mm. But this is the problem, innate problems of having these inflexible, strident, fundamentalist religious views.
Yeah,
is that they fly in the face of real human experience. You know, obviously, most people want to be left alone by their governments.
Yes.
They don't want their governments saying, oh, this is how you must engage in your private sex life. This is the sort of medical care that you can expect to have, and you can't expect this kind of other sort of medical care. Conservatives, right? Especially conservative Republicans always campaign on a platform of less government, let's get government out of everybody's lives. Well, and they deride liberals, you know, they pull out the L word and say, those are the bad guys who want big government and government in your face all the time, and so don't trust those guys, trust us.
Yeah.
Then conservatives get elected, and what do? They side with the most extreme fundamentalist religious people to make laws designed to curtail individual rights.
Individual rights, yes. Typically, the difference I've always seen is that Republicans and conservatives want to get out of your business life. You can do whatever you want in terms of business practices, but in your social life, as long as you're not going home to another man, we'll leave you alone. Whereas liberals, typically, you know, we don't mind if you go home with another man, as long as when you go to work, you know, you're doing it under our rules. So... But that's a completely different topic.
Yeah, completely. I'm sorry. I went off on a tangent there. So what else is happening?
Anyway. But the partnership has also provided the administration with an opportunity to demonstrate that it shares many social values with Islam at a time when the United States is being criticized in the Muslim world for its continued support of Israel and 9-month-old war on terrorism. Unfortunately, we share social values, but not everyone here does.
Yeah.
So... We have tried to point out that there are some areas of agreement between us and a lot of Islamic countries in these social issues, a U.S. official said.
Well, the point is, though, right, here in the States, we have a secular government. We have a secular constitution.
We try to.
Yeah, we try to. I mean, in reality, it doesn't necessarily get put into practice all the time, but that is what the Constitution guarantees, right?
Yes.
So it's utterly inappropriate to say, oh, well, you know, the Christian, specifically Christian values or Muslim values or values that are somehow exclusive to religion, which I don't really know that you can make an argument that there are that many of those that aren't shared by secular philosophies at the same time, are the right philosophies for everyone to live by all the time. You know, I mean, there were many secular societies in the world that have exactly the same kinds of laws, you know, throughout history. They're all rooted in the same basic fundamental principles of people need to be good to one another.
Yeah.
And it's when you start having rigid fundamentalist doctrines governing your laws that you start having things that are unfair and unjust and unequal.
Yeah. And the only reason it's unfair and unjust and unequal is because it says so in one book.
Mm.
Well, yeah, one book.
Well, so. R2, you know, Bible, Quran, whoever... Whatever your favorite
one
book.
Is the Quran just the beginning of the Bible?
No.
It's not?
No.
It's a completely different text?
It's a completely different text.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Anyway.
There are parallels to things, but it's not...
But yeah, it's a completely separate...
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. You may be thinking of the Torah, which has...
Okay.
Yeah. Which is
the
Jewish...
Okay, that's just the first couple books. Yeah.
All right. Which has more similar... Which I have not... I'm slowly working my way through the Quran on the web.
Okay.
But I haven't picked up a Torah, so...
Okay. Here. All right.
But
okay, now on science news, why not?
Science!
Australian scientists claim teleporting success.
Ooh.
A team of physicists at the Australian National University announced on Monday that they had successfully disembodied a laser beam in one location and rebuilt it in a different spot about 1 meter away in the blink of an eye.
Hmm.
Despite the fact that it would have gotten there on its own quicker.
Well...
But that's beside the point.
Yeah.
Project leader Dr. Ping Koi Lam said there was a close resemblance between what his team had achieved and the movement of people in a science fiction series Star Trek, but reality is still light years off beaming human beings between locations.
Mm.
In theory, there is nothing stopping us from doing it, but the complexity of the problem is so huge that no one is thinking seriously about it at the moment.
Hmm.
However, Lamb said science was not too far from being able to teleport solid matter from one location to another.
Hmm.
My prediction is it will be done by someone in the next 3 to 5 years.
3 to 5 years?
That is a teleportation of a single atom.
Oh, okay. So
it's getting there.
Before you can, like...
Slowly, but it's getting there.
Yeah. So before you... We have the time when you order merchandise online from places like Amazon and various websites.
Yep, and you show
and you
up
order it, and you pay it, and then
teleportation
they,
reality
and then
box
they teleport,
on your computer.
And then once your credit card clears, they beam the item to your house.
That would be nice.
Which would... That's still many, many decades away.
Yes, UPS will have slight issues with that one.
Yeah. So... No, they'll just have to go into the beaming business.
There you go.
They'll just have to expand.
Secure beaming.
Yeah.
The breakthrough opens up enormous possibilities for future super fast and super secure communication systems such as quantum computers over the next decade. Mm. Now, actually, what they're doing here, the technology behind it is a little bit different. The idea of a quantum particle, like electrons, ions, and atoms, have the same properties. They are essentially the same. So if the properties of quantum particles making up an object are reproduced in another particle group, there would be a precise duplication of the object. Mm-hmm. So only information about the particle's properties need to be transmitted, not the particles. So essentially what they're doing is they're not picking up the laser beam or the person from here, deconstructing it, sending it over there, and putting it down again. What they're actually doing is saying, okay, this atom is right here, and it's spinning this way, and it's got this much energy, and so we'll make one over here that does the exact same thing.
So they're not so they didn't really it wasn't the same laser beam then.
No.
They just copied it.
Yes.
And they disintegrated the first one.
Yes.
So that means if they
If they try and do this to us and something goes a little bit haywire,
yeah,
you'll just blow up.
You're gone, but there's a copy of you.
Yes. Yes.
And so that's a little too risky. Yeah. So
again, depending on the technology and stuff like that, you know, you can argue that that's really the same thing. I mean, we're just essentially, you know, neurons and electrons and chemical process and stuff like that. And so if you duplicate me down there, it's the same thing.
Yeah, but then this, of course, there would have to be major advances in understanding, for example, neurology.
Exactly.
Because if they be as if this copy of you is suddenly reconstructed everywhere, but you have no memories and you're drooling and you don't know how to, you know,
well,
and
again,
you're wetting yourself.
The theory isn't all that much different because they can read all the properties of an atom, and then they can give those properties to another atom over here. It's just considering how many atoms you're actually made up of.
Yeah.
It's going to take a long time to do.
But we still need more greater understanding of, for example, how the brain works and stores information and stores memory, because that, I mean, that's what makes you, right?
Because of the speed in which we would do it, yes.
Yeah.
However, not necessarily, because if you're building the same things, exactly the same properties from here to here, you don't have to understand how it works. If I look inside of some old radio with just a whole bunch of wires running around it, I don't need to know why each of those wires works, as long as I create something over here that's exactly the same. I take a red wire.
But a radio doesn't have the information, a lifetime of information stored in the radio.
No, but it's just a super complicated radio.
Well, let's say something like a CD-ROM. Okay, CD that has several megabytes of information burned onto it.
Yes.
So here's a physical object that has information stored on it.
Yes.
Now, let's say you were able to beam that physical CD-ROM. You know, the metal and the plastic and the coating and everything, the physical properties of that from location A to location B. But the risk would be that the CD that you would get over here, which it would be an exact duplicate of the CD, could be an exact duplicate of the CD you just beamed, except this one might be blank. I mean...
No, because then it wouldn't be an exact copy. Think of it like this.
We don't know enough about how the brain stores information.
My only point is we don't have to. Think of it this way.
Well,
and we'll try and get back on topic soon.
Well, this is science, people. What are you doing? Okay.
Think of it this way. If I had a Japanese textbook here,
okay,
you don't need to understand Japanese to copy it over there.
Right.
You just need to copy the exact same lines and crosses and dots across there, and everything will be transmitted.
Yeah, okay.
You don't know a single thing of what you just did.
That's true. No, I understand I understand what you're getting at.
But this is a similar problem.
I've had this similar to discussions like Jeff D., our nonprofit's host, is very big into what's called transhumanism.
Yes.
Which involves various life extension technologies that, that's a serious thing that science is working on. I mean, there's no reason that human beings can't live for far, far longer than we're living now.
Yeah, yeah.
But one potential technology involves actually uploading. Like, the contents of your brain get stored in this massive computer, and...
And you download that into a little buggy with a camera. And
or either that, or either into some sort of very, very highly technologically advanced robot, Blade Runner-style robots ever come into existence.
Yeah.
Or just a new cloned body of you.
Yes.
You know, like, you get old and your body wears out, but they take your DNA and they just make a new you out of it, and then when the new you is...
There you go.
You know, just install the old memories from the old old you into the new you.
Reformat the drive, put it back on.
But some people have criticized that, saying, oh, but wait, you're not really moving you from one brain to another brain. It's like the same thing as on the Mac. You know, you drag the little icon of the file over to the disk. You haven't, all you've done is you've made a copy. It's a duplication.
Yeah.
It's
but it has the exact same information.
Yeah, see, that's not the problem. Is it really you, or is it just a copy of you?
I'm on Jeff's side with this one, because we have no evidence that there's anything outside of the chemical and chemical processes in the brain.
Yeah.
And so if you put me to sleep, download the contents of my brain into a machine, and then put it onto somebody else, and you don't wake me up, do not wake me up. Then it'll be okay.
There's a science fiction movie in this somewhere.
Because I'll just wake up in another bed, essentially. And so it's possible.
So even if it is a copy of you, it's got all the memories, the, you know, and because that's what makes you you. It's that electrochemical in your brain that stores your memories, and the memories are what comprise your personality, all your experiences.
Exactly.
So as long as that's preserved.
Exactly.
You know.
So.
But would the copy know? Would you know if you were the copy? Ah, we're getting on it.
If you go to sleep and you wake up on a different bed, you're the copy.
Yes.
You wake up on the same bed.
But what if
they switched you in the night?
What if both of you wake up? What if the older version that's about to die is awake?
Well, that's what I'm saying. If you wake up in the same place that you went to sleep, you're the original one and be scared.
Yeah.
If your one wakes up in the new bed, then you're okay. You can breathe a sigh of relief.
Mm-hmm. But so we still have to figure out how to make that so that, you know,
Yes.
I mean, it's not just duplicating one set of, you know, information from one body to another. You know, it's actually removing that and installing it instead of just duplicating from, you know, brain A to brain B.
Yeah.
You're actually physically taking out all the information that's in brain A, putting it in brain B so that the body B with brain B is the person and not just... You know,
and there are a couple different routes to get that information. Do we want to understand what's going on in the brain so that we can duplicate that?
Well, I think we should. I mean, you know,
or
why shouldn't we understand it? I mean, what would be there's no downside.
That would be a better way to do it, because you could probably get it done easier and quicker and safer and more secure and everything.
Well, there you go. I mean, that's justification.
But there's still reason to be held out for the brute force method of just copy atom A from here to here.
Yeah.
And
well, I'm more attracted to the other...
Because right now, we could theoretically program in a brain. You just, you know, look at the brain, see how the neurons react and stuff like that, and then take this neuron, see what it does, and program it on the computer. Take this one, do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
You will have a working brain on a computer, essentially.
Yeah.
It'll be huge. It's ugly.
Mm-hmm.
But it would theoretically work.
Right.
Just not the most efficient way.
I'm more attracted to, you know, like the other transhumanist technologies, which would be like, for example, just fixing your DNA so that you don't need to age and die.
Exactly.
I mean, like,
why?
The telomeres.
But then again, there's something to be said for being transported into some kind of different kind of body. Right now, I can't go to the bottom of the ocean or out into space in this body.
Yeah.
At least not without serious mechanical help.
So if
and
they,
so
if they
be kind of nice
if they develop these amazing replicants that we can all install ourselves into, and we can go into outer space without spacesuits.
Why can't I buy a host of different bodies? One with a rocket, one with a little scooter, one with paddles on it so you can go in the ocean.
I have a little sunroof.
Yeah, and I just decide what I want to do that day.
Uh huh.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, a little rocket in your pocket. Yeah.
So
you get all kinds of different attachments. You can like
exactly.
Well, it gets silly. You have wings, you know.
Yeah. Why not?
Yeah.
It'd be awesome.
Hmm.
So,
I have a little more sci-fi to talk about in a minute, but we'll do another news.
Well,
and then
actually, do we want to get on to that? It is almost
well, we have this. Oh, yeah. Okay. What the hell? Let's go ahead. We'll this is a live call-in program. We'll put that phone number up on the air. And while we're waiting for calls to rack up, I did want to talk just briefly about something because it is on topic.
Which topic?
Well, philosophical type stuff,
okay.
But mixing in with scientific advances is that. I saw Minority Report yesterday.
Ooh, good.
Have you seen that yet?
No, I want to.
Yeah. Okay, well, I won't spoil anything. It's a very interesting film. It's not perfect. It's not without its flaws. But a much more successful movie than, say, AI was. Much more. And it's interesting in that it does attempt to deal thematically with such concepts as predestination and free will and... Well, it deals more successfully, I think, with like privacy issues, because what you have is this future when, the basic premise of the movie, of course, is that in Washington, D.C., they have these three precognitive these three people who have powers of precognition, which are the result of some, you know, of like a bioengineering accident, basically.
Wow. Okay.
And they found that they can foresee murders. Okay. They say they can only foresee murders, because apparently that's the most that's such a profoundly destructive act.
Okay. That so it's they don't a do it for parking ticket then.
No.
Okay.
Although there's an inconsistency in one scene in the movie later on, but that's beside the point. But so what's interesting is that there is now this organization called the Department of Pre-Crime, which is this police force that uses these precogs, and they have them floating in this tank, to foresee murders before they occur, and the cops go out and bust the perp before he actually does the deed. And this has resulted in, like, eliminating murder in Washington, D.C., which would probably be the only way you can do it, because it's like a murder capital next to Detroit, right?
Yeah.
And there are some very interesting scenes in the movie that are dealing with the philosophical implications of that. There's a character played by Colin, you know, Tom Cruise's main guy. And Colin Farrell plays this young hotshot with the Attorney General's office who actually wants to find flaws in pre-crime because he has problems with it. And they have this discussion about, if you prevent the crime, how do you know these precogs aren't really foreseeing the future, right? Because if you prevent this crime from happening, then it's not the future.
Yeah.
And Tom Cruise makes the point, if you stop it, that doesn't mean it wasn't going to happen. And he throws this ball at him, or he like rolls it off the table, and Colin Farrell catches it, and Tom says, "Why'd you catch it?" I said, "Well, was it going to fall?" He said, "But it didn't fall. You caught it." You know.
Yeah.
So the fact that you prevented it was going to happen. So it's interesting that it deals with that. But the flaw in the movie is that the movie doesn't trust that philosophical premise well enough to carry the whole movie. So what you get is a similar problem that I had with AI, where about the real ending of Minority Report happens about 20 minutes before the movie actually ends.
Oh, yes.
And then they go on later on with this incredibly contrived, big twist ending that all movies think they have to have now. And that's a shame because it actually makes it more conventional. I mean, when you see the movie, you'll know the scene where the movie should end.
It should have ended here.
It should end here.
Okay.
And that ending would have demonstrated the real flaw in pre-crime, which would have made the whole department, morally wrong and shut it down. Yeah. And then you would have had like this, character arc with the Tom Cruise character saying, "Oh, well, because he's very, very committed to pre-crime. He's totally devoted and a believer in it." But what's interesting was that they made the Colin Farrell character, the guy who wants to shut pre-crime down, they made him profoundly religious. He's very religious. He's always quoting scripture.
Wow.
He points out the similarity between the precogs and these oracles that old society used to go to.
Okay.
They call the place where they store the precogs, they have some nickname for it. Like, I think they call it it's not the chapel, but it's something, altar or something like that. So there's religious metaphors there. But I found it interesting that they made the Colin Farrell character deeply religious because, of course, Christianity has this innate dilemma reconciling divine omniscience with human free will.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, you hit a Christian with, the problem of evil, and they immediately respond with, "Oh, well, God gives us free will, and that's why bad stuff happens." And the problem with that, of course, is, but if God is omniscient and he can see the future with 100% accuracy and clarity... Yeah. Don't really have free will. It might seem like free will. I mean, it's like, I'm making the decision to do this. Yeah. I'm making the decision to do something. And even it's something that if it's something that God doesn't want you to do, he still knows in advance that this is what you're going to do.
Yeah.
And that calls into question whether or not, we would all be just robots following a script, which is the thing that free will is supposed to prevent.
God is the pre-crime unit of this movie. He just doesn't do anything about it.
Yeah.
He doesn't try and stop the murders. He just says, okay, well, let him go.
Yeah, so what you have this pre-crime unit that's doing the thing that if God existed, maybe he ought to be doing. Because atheists always bring up that point, too. I mean, we always say, look, why doesn't God stop things like 9/11 and stuff like this? It's going to result in horrible strife and woe and death. And Christians always bring up, free will and various defenses like that.
Adam and Eve had free will. Why didn't you let them eat of the tree of knowledge?
Yeah. So it's interesting. It's interesting that the movie would bring up this interesting little thorny philosophical point. And definitely have these characters doing what you would think this omnibenevolent God ought to be doing if he could foresee events happening. So it's fascinating, and it's a shame that the movie, that Spielberg and the screenwriters didn't trust that underlying premise to carry it all the way through. They had to come up with this completely, why Benson it up, and who's the... and it becomes completely predictable at that point who the bad guy really is and this and that. And it's and I was so saddened to see that like this movie went kind of from here to here in its last 20 minutes. Still worth seeing though. Okay, still worth seeing.
Yeah, I do want to see it because I just want to see their explanation for why not just counsel these people. You know, I mean, if I got a knock at my door, if I knew that pre-crime existed and they actually do this, if a policeman came to my door and said, you're going to murder somebody in 2 weeks if you continue on this course,
that's interesting. The
watch
movie
your ass.
Doesn't deal with that. The movie, they don't deal with that. They just swoop in and arrest these guys.
Yeah, if you tell me I'm going to do it, I won't do it. Yeah, I'll watch out.
But when you think about it, though, that is how some sort of, like, police force would handle that situation. They wouldn't, send, because that's like some, that's just some woolly-headed liberal idea, to go out and counsel these guys who's about to do murder, right? But they also mentioned that because pre-crime has been so effective, you don't get very many premeditated murders where like somebody's like, okay, a week from now I'm gonna rub out my. You don't get premeditated.
Also, people go berserk.
Yeah. So what they have are these crimes of passion, where it's like this spur of the moment thing. There's this completely brilliant opening sequence where this husband who's like suspecting his wife. And he finds out, and so he's like, oh, I'm going off to work, honey. And then he hides behind the train or whoever shows up. And then this cross cuts with crews trying to find where this is about to happen. They're trying to find the location. They have very limited time.
Yeah.
To find it because it's going to be a crime of passion and a spur of the moment thing. The precogs don't get that much advance warning on it.
Okay.
So they have like seconds to spare.
Yeah.
And that's very believable because you can think about how, the husband discovers his wife having this affair. He's devastated. And it's only maybe in the minute before he would actually do it that he just impulsively grabs the knife and does it. And so that would be a different situation than some premeditated murder.
Do these people, are they able to see the future or do they read people's minds?
They actually,
that's the difference. If you read the mind, then crime of passion will be something that they have seconds.
They see the future events. They see the events, and they transmit these events. I mean, they have these computer screens where the cops can foresee like these blurry images going on, and they're trying to identify. Where's the location? Oh, there's an envelope on the table. Can you read it? No, I can't. Oh, where is this happening? So that's really brilliantly set up. So it's a shame that they didn't follow it all the way through. But it's interesting to see mainstream Hollywood movie tackle these kinds of religious. Because the Minority Report's based on a Philip K. Dick story, and Philip K. Dick also was the author who did the original Blade Runner.
Okay.
And that was a movie that took on, I think more successfully, another really thorny philosophical problem, which is all about they have this future with these incredible replicant robots that are, more human than human.
Okay.
And somebody along the line thought, oh, wait a minute, we've just made people that are better than people. And they install the 4-year lifespan. They kill them off early as this sort of fail-safe device. And so the movie then discusses the issue of, do you have the right to take life just because you create life?
Yeah.
And what's interesting there is Christians will always say yes to that. I mean, every debate I've heard, I'm a Christian, whenever I bring up Old Testament atrocities and God killing these guys.
Well, they apply it to God, but they apply it to their own kids.
Well, they don't apply it to God, they don't apply it to themselves, I'm sorry, but they do apply it to God. Just the basic premise
because they don't create life, they just...
Well, they say, I've always heard Christians say, look, if God is as the creator of life, just has this natural, if he wants to kill you, he can. And for no other reason than that he's God. And that's a real, I think that, I know I have a problem with that.
Yeah.
I don't think you do. I don't think, because again, if you're not applying that same principle to parents with their children, I don't think you're being entirely consistent there.
But then again, in their eyes, they're not creating life. They're just allowing God's will to happen or something. Yeah. Fluffy piece of garbage like
that. Anyway, it's an interesting movie, and I think it provides a lot of food for thought, and it seemed to me to be really kind of on topic today.
Yeah.
And I think, that's perfect, because we've lined up a whole heck of a lot of callers.
Yep,
and
most definitely time.
We'll just hit them. I think Juan is on line one. Let's see what he has to say. Juan?
Hey, enjoy your show.
Thank you. Thanks.
I wanted to first comment on some of your previous arguments you mentioned about the movie, or not about the movie, but...
Don't give anything away.
let's not spoil it for people who haven't seen it.
I haven't seen it, so no problem.
Okay.
But you'd mentioned about whether or not God question, and I'm not trying to be a God advocate here, but just saying that you had mentioned that God had, you know, does he know your future? But I don't think it's that important whether or not he knows a predetermined future as much as it seems like with this new type of three-dimensional and multiple, what you would call it, worlds and stuff, that different things can happen, that he could know every possibility. So therefore, he could know the future. It's just that, and he could know when what would happen, what is going to happen based on probability. I mean, he has those in his mind, I suppose, or her mind.
Well, like I think, that, I mean, it's an interesting point, but I think that what you do hear, typically you hear Christians arguing for, is this omniscient God, who, you're right, he would know all possible outcomes of a situation, but omniscience would allow him to know the one that would happen out of all those possibilities at the same time.
Well, it is a matter of definition, I'd agree. I mean, it is a matter of how you would define it, but I would suggest that would be a compelling enough argument to suggest that he would know the future and that he doesn't necessarily discount our own free will.
Yeah. But then that takes into account, then that runs into problems when you have such a concept like omnibenevolence, because an omnibenevolent God, which is a God of unconditional love, right, would not want harm to befall anybody for any reason whatsoever. So, although you could say that an omniscient God who lacks omnibenevolence would foresee, say, a very harmful and tragic event forecoming, like an earthquake or 9/11 or something like that, a God lacking omnibenevolence would foresee it coming but not necessarily feel any obligation to step in and do it. But an omnibenevolent God would step in. An omnibenevolent God who loves everybody without condition, without any sort of need to justify it other than that he is a being of pure goodness and pure love would say, stop this because this is going to kill people and that's a bad thing. I mean, a morally perfect omnibenevolent God would. Well, by his very nature, he would not be able not to stop it.
Well, I guess I would agree with that. I mean, my whole thing is that if he was omnibenevolent, I would suggest that if you were to take it further and say it's omnibenevolent to all life. And what I mean to say is that maybe he's omnibenevolent first to the earth, maybe he's omnibenevolent to animals. Mm-hmm. Depends upon the balance of things. Yeah. And so in that sense, I could define this omnibenevolence not in the sense of human life, but in the sense of all life. And in that sense, I could suggest that what might seem to be an unbalance in terms of death for certain types of creatures, it would be a certain balance in the overall harmony of things.
Okay.
Now, like I said, I'm not a pro-God thing. It just doesn't seem...
Well, no, I mean, you're bringing up interesting points.
And the only problem I would have with something like that, if he's omnipotent and he can do anything that he wants and he knows everything, then it seems like he would be able to come up with a better way of doing things.
Yes.
Than having to kill one thing so that another thing can live. You know, I have to, you know, we don't have to, but we typically kill animals to eat. I would rather see something where that doesn't have to happen. Another way of doing
things,
basically.
Well, you go veg, basically. I mean, that's the way.
I accidentally run over ants on the highway.
Well, you're right. A God of omnipotent powers would have no limits to whatever means at his disposal were available to strike that sort of harmonious balance in nature that you refer to. So you're right. The minute I have occasionally heard Christians argue, say, well, this is really the only way God can do this. And
that's
then
a limitation on God.
Yeah, and I say, well, the minute you put a limitation on one of God's abilities, you've taken away one of the omnis. And remember, the problem of evil only destroys the notion of a God who possesses supposedly possesses the characteristics of omniscience, you know, knows everything, past, present, and future, omnipotence, absolutely no limits whatsoever to his powers, and omnibenevolence, which is unconditional love and moral perfection. Now, if you want to argue for a God in which you take away one of the omnis, one or two, or even all of the omnis, well then, the problem of evil isn't, you know, then you have other criticisms and the problem of evil gets to be moot. But, you know, I've never heard a practicing Christian who didn't want to continue to defend this concept of a God who had all three omnis in place, omniscience, omnipotence, omnibenevolence. They want to have all of these properties available in their God, and yet, clearly, at that point, the problem of evil is a real problem. So... But you brought up some really interesting points. And
But actually, that wasn't really what I wanted to talk about.
Sure, well,
you
okay.
Know, actually, what I wanted to talk about was, one, I feel like, personally, I've watched a couple of your shows now, mm-hmm. and one thing, your number is wrong. On the website, it's 472-2288, and it's actually 477.
Okay, do we have that up on, do we have the old phone number, the bad phone number up on screen?
Oh, no, it was in the website, but they
oh,
you
okay.
hardly
the
put
the website,
up the
okay,
on.
Well, that's okay. That's no, Russell's thing, and we'll fix that up. For
take
the,
note
and,
of that.
Thank you for alerting us.
But the other thing I had was the atheist versus agnostic, and I was curious as to why you made, it sounds like you're not trying to prove that God doesn't exist as much as you're trying to prove that they can't prove that God exists. And to me, that doesn't necessarily, I question whether or not you believe God exists.
Well, I don't believe God exists.
Okay. Okay. So
let me clarify the definitions for you. The terms Gnosticism and agnosticism refer to knowledge, whereas theism and atheism are terms that refer to what a person does or doesn't believe. So knowledge and belief are two different topics. Now, I am agnostic in that I will confess that I do not have any sort of definite knowledge that there isn't a God or anything that could possibly be called a God.
Right.
However, I am also an atheist in that I disbelieve the claims of God that I'm hearing due to what I either consider to be a profound lack of evidence or definitions of God that are innately contradictory, which is what I think Christianity, for example, provides. So as atheists, the only thing that we claim is that we don't believe. We're not taking a positive position on the issue. We're just saying theists haven't proven that any of their gods exist, so until they do, we will refrain from belief. It's just like somebody coming to you and saying, I have an elf that lives in my backyard. If they don't provide evidence for their elf, then nobody has any real reason to believe them when they say they have an elf. And there's, of course, there's also the principle of extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence, right? Mm-hmm. So the claim that there's a big, invisible, all-powerful being that controls the universe, or I have an elf in my backyard, is a different quality of claim than, I had a Subway sandwich for lunch yesterday. I mean, one's an extraordinary claim and one's not so extraordinary. Lots of people have Subway sandwiches for lunch. But not everyone, or at least very few people, or no people that I know in my experience, have elves that live in their backyards. And I haven't seen evidence of some big invisible being, managing the universe yet. So if those claims are being made, then the person asserting the positive claim is the person who bears the burden of proof for that, and I'm perfectly happy to listen to whatever evidence or proof they provide. If I don't consider, if I don't consider that evidence compelling or convincing, then I will remain an unbeliever until I hear better evidence.
Yeah.
So that's those are the differences between the terms. And if the fact page doesn't make it clear, then we'll look at how it's written and see if it needs to be made more clear.
So the atheist is a person that seeks knowledge, but an agnostic is more, in your opinion, more of a personal belief or a personal value.
No. You got it backwards. Agnosticism is an admission of, we're not omnipotent. I mean, omniscient, right? We don't know everything. An agnostic is willing to say, hey, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. And I would think that, pretty much everybody in the world, if they wanted to be honest about their position, would have to admit to some degree of agnosticism. I mean, nobody really knows.
Yeah, knows for certain.
So the whole question of the existence or non-existence of deities really does come down to belief or disbelief. Either if lacking knowledge, a person then either will choose to believe or disbelieve in the existence of these beings. And the people who believe are, the ones then who ought to be providing the evidence to those who continue not to believe.
And I think that was important. For me, I think it's an important distinction because it helps me discuss the issue a little better in terms of if you say atheist community, or let's say that, at least I can define it a little better. My problem is that I couldn't teach my kids to be atheists. I couldn't tell them to go pronounce to everybody to be atheists. I feel like there is a social pressure that forces us to comply. Otherwise, our kids are going to get kicked, they're going to get, and to me, I hate that. I feel a very big prejudice against thought.
And actually, you'd be kind of surprised by that. Actually, this came up on an email list just, I think, yesterday, maybe today. Somebody was asking on the email list saying, are you, And as much as I don't like this term for atheism, it still kind of fits. Are you out about being an atheist at work and at home and stuff like that? And I basically reply back and I say, yes, I am very much so at work. And when that actually happened, I got pretty much all positive responses. Even my manager, I think I was on, we were doing the tryouts for co-host in December, I think it was. I went on a couple times in December. My manager came in. I went into work Tuesday morning, and he was like, hey, saw you on TV. Cool. And, and so, yeah, I mean, I go to the team meeting at the end of the week, and he's like, yeah, Ashley was on this TV show, and talking about atheism, and it's on at this time and this channel.
Oh,
and,
great.
You know, I mean, yeah, he was promoting the show and everything. And so,
different.
So, yeah, I mean, I'm getting you know, a lot of uptime for it.
Yeah.
So.
We gotta go ahead and take our next caller, but we do appreciate hearing from you, Juan. You made up some really excellent points.
Don't take it easy on these Christians. I get tired of them. They're, you give them too much credit, and I wish you would just, you know, pound on them about some of these things, because it just irritates me too.
Well, we pound on people who deserve a good pounding, but at the same time, I mean, we don't want to be perceived as like, oh, we're the mean bullies who are out here. We want to make sure that people understand our points.
Right.
So that's more important to us than gratifying our egos or anything like that. But believe me,
good old time. Yeah,
we are fair on the Atheist Experience, but you know you get what you give here at the same time. Juan, right. We appreciate hearing from you, and feel free to call us back anytime.
Great.
Thanks, Sean. Okay. Also, one other thing I wanted to bring up too touched on burden of proof and stuff like that. The burden of proof also has to fall on the person who can actually prove something.
Well, sure. If you take
God's definition as omniscient and omnibenevolent, but he's not, you know, you know, if you cut out one of the omnis, we can't prove that God exists, period. You know, he could be hiding under a rock in Missouri for some reason. There's no way to prove that. But the believer could come up with some kind of evidence or some way to prove that this being exists. So.
Well, remember, what you often hear, and a reaction that you often hear from Christians is that, well, you guys can't prove God doesn't exist, and therefore being an atheist requires just as much faith as... And what you have to assert is that disbelief is not a faith position, okay?
Yes.
Disbelief is simply a position saying, hey, you haven't proved your assertion to me yet, so you haven't given me any good reason to believe.
Yeah.
It's like if somebody wants you to buy a used car... And so if I come to you and say, Ashley, I got this really, really awesome used car to sell you, what's the first question you're going to ask me?
One, how old is it? I would assume.
Well, I'm, you know, come on.
We should rehearse these things before.
No, I don't want you giving a canned answer. Okay, if that's the first one. But a lot of people would say, well, can I see it, right? Can I look at the car? Can I take it for a test drive? Can I do it? Right. And now I say, no, you can't. I'm sorry, I can't let you see the car. It's at my uncle's house. That's it. Yeah, but it's a really great car, and I'll let you have it for, you know, $1,000 or whatever. And so it's sort of like, you, without having actually seen evidence that there even is a car, much less that it's a car that runs, that has tires,
worth $1,000.
That has that's worth your buying. Without being given good evidence to believe, you've got no reason to believe that I even have a car to sell you. I could be some grifter. I could just be trying to scam you for $1,000, right?
Yeah.
So you need good evidence. And it's not you are not taking a faith-based position in choosing to be cautious.
Of course.
You know, and choosing to say, I don't really know that I believe you have this car. That's not a faith-based position on your part. That's you saying, you asserting that you have a great used car to sell me for $1,000, haven't proven to me your claim that you indeed have this.
Yeah.
And so that's you, disbelief is you exercising common sense. It's not the same thing as a faith-based position where you are asserting a positive claim.
Yes.
Still in the absence of good evidence. So that's the big difference. And as I also say, Juan was talking about teaching kids to be atheists. You're right, I think that the thing that's important to do is to teach critical thinking.
Let them make up their own minds.
Let them make up their own minds. Okay, Norman is on line two. Norman?
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, thanks for waiting.
Hey, thanks. It's cool that we're on the topic of proof. I know we're just discussing that because it kind of ties in a little bit. I have two questions for you.
Sure.
The first one is, for you, what explanation has satisfied the question of the origin of life? What explanation or theory and what proof has been demonstrated to you to settle that question? I'm talking about proof as in someone demonstrating to you unequivocally with empirical evidence that this is the way that life originated. And the second question is, what are your reasons for disbelieving the testimony of the writers of the New Testament, namely Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Paul, okay. Peter, Timothy, all those guys.
Okay. I'll tell you, do you want to go first, or do you want me to go first?
Sure, I'll go ahead and run.
Okay, because I've got answers to both of these. I want to go ahead and outline them first, though.
Yeah, I'm assuming what you're kind of asking about is evolution. Now, evolution is where life goes after you have life. It doesn't say anything about where life came from in the beginning.
Yeah, that's what I'm curious about. As far as I'm curious about your mind and what has become settled for you about the origin of life.
Okay, I can answer.
Not evolution.
I can give you a quick answer to that. I mean, I know you were starting, okay. but we might be on the same page here. I don't think the question of the origins, the absolute origins of life, has been settled conclusively.
Exactly.
I don't think that is an issue that has been settled. That's a topic. That's called abiogenesis.
Yes.
That's the study of the actual origins of life. There are a number of theories, and they're being followed up on, and until we have really, really good solid evidence one way or another to back up one particular theory, it remains an open question.
Yeah.
There's an interesting theory called panspermia, which seems to have I don't know panspermia itself, but there's a similar, the whole idea that organic materials that are the fundamental building blocks of life, the amino acids, the proteins that you need to have, we know that they are present throughout space.
Yes.
We have detected organic materials. They are very common, especially around very young, hot, white stars that are just forming. So we know that organic materials are actually in abundance in the universe. So so a theory has arisen that, either through meteors or right. through some... when the planet was in its primordial state, all this stuff just kind of dropped onto Earth. Now, of course, we don't know that for certain, but it's what we have to do is look at the available evidence that you have, and it's still a wide open field of study, and that's what makes it exciting.
So when you say it's an open question, is it open to design theory?
Well,
if they can come up with absolutely any evidence to show that it was actually designed and placed here...
There is no evidence whatsoever. For this, what Martin just described, and yet it's a theory that's...
There actually is evidence, because they have found those molecules around other places in space. They have seen comets where in the tail of comets they have these molecules.
Okay.
We found organic material in micrometeorites. But
yes,
okay, to answer your question, yes, if someone wants to propose design theory, intelligent design theory, then it is up to them to provide the evidence for their theory. And right now, that there are a great many criticisms of at least what's been offered so far by biologists and by people who are hearing what the design advocates are saying and responding to it. And if you want to read some of those, now we're not biologists, we're not scientists, so I can't go into... I don't know the details of what all of the back and forth the debate has been, but I can point you to a couple good sources if our fine producer will kick... There we go. The talk.origins.org website, or the talkorigins.org website, deals with the whole creation evolution debate, and it provides like a lot of scientific criticisms of creationist positions. And then RichardDawkins.com also does the same thing. That's not the official website of Richard Dawkins, who's the zoologist and the evolution advocate, but it has a lot of papers by, for example, there's a fellow named Michael Behe. Who was a critic of evolution and who's published a book, and Michael Behe is actually a microbiologist.
Yes.
And so there are responses by his. So what you get to hear is an actual microbiologist responding to a microbiologist.
Right. Exactly.
And so that's a better source for.
So would
for
you
those
be
debates.
Open? Would the two of you be open to the design theory being presented in textbooks?
Here's the problem. I don't think that intelligent design has yet to gather enough sufficient evidence to be called in scientific terms a theory.
But
naturalistic terms is not the same thing as scientific terms.
Oh, I understand, but that's my point.
Yeah, see, in science, right now, at best, intelligent design, I think, could be called a hypothesis. Until something has a really good solid body of evidence that seems to back it up, you don't really get to be called a theory. I mean,
selection.
Yeah, in everyday parlance, right? In everyday, just vernacular, the word theory can mean something like, oh, it's just something a guy made up.
Right.
But in science, it doesn't mean
that. I understand that.
Yeah. So until right now, at this point, it doesn't look like intelligence design, unfortunately, has enough behind it to justify being called a theory, because...
Like what would be one example? Would natural selection be one?
Well, natural selection has to do with...
I know, evolution.
That's an evolutionary theory.
And
we have seen speciation take place. We do have good evidence of that. Natural selection, remember, simply involves the ability of organisms to adapt over time to changes in their environment. That's what natural selection refers to. And a lot of people in the creationist community, particularly the ID guys that you're talking about, already have conceded that microevolution does occur. And that's where you do see, within individual species, changes taking place in response to adaptations that are necessary to the environment. Intelligent design guys have a problem with macroevolution.
That's right.
The scientific community responds by saying, you know, macroevolution is not all that special. It's just microevolution on a larger scale. A lot of us attended. There was an ID debate back at the end of February, here in town, and a lot of us attended that, and we discussed it actually in detail on this program. We critiqued the position of the ID supporter and talked about. And on our website, and I think on the past events page, Russell Glasser, who's the producer of this show, you know, posted his critique of at least the points that one guy made. So you can go there and, you know, check out World of Dawkins, check out Talk Origins, and see what the different sides are saying.
Okay, cool.
Like I said, I don't, Ashley and I, we're willing to admit, yes, the unknown exists. Okay, there are things that are unknown that we don't know about. Until we have good evidence, the only appropriate response, right, to questions that you don't have the answer to is, I don't know. It's not appropriate to insert a belief into gaps in your knowledge.
Well, I think that's what a number of naturalistic scientists have done.
Okay.
I mean, there's just little question about that. I mean, Darwin did it. They all used words like hope and belief when they got into their theory.
You gotta
be at least somewhat honest about the words and the terms that they used in their everyday language.
Do you have a passage from Darwin or anyone else who says that? I mean, can you quote from, I guess, Origin of Species or something where?
Yep. Go on with the next question. I'll find that quote, bro.
Yeah. But here's the thing, though. Yes, I mean, science involves a great deal of speculation, right? And that's part of the whole nature of it. You know, you have a question about, well, how does this thing work? It could work this way, or maybe it could work that way, or maybe it could work the other way. So you go out and you look and you see what the evidence has to say. It appears that, unfortunately, evolutionary biology does have a tremendous amount of good, solid, hard, tangible, testable, falsifiable evidence, you know, to support it.
And actually,
right now.
What's in that is, again, going back to this theory thing, gravity is also a theory, technically, according to science. Evolution is kind of on par with gravity in terms of how sure they are. The theories behind it aren't really, did evolution happen, but exactly what are the mechanics behind it. We don't know if it was natural selection. We don't know if it was punctuated equilibria.
Stephen Jay Gould was a big punctuated equilibrium.
Yeah, there are a couple different ideas on the actual mechanics behind it and how it happened.
Yeah.
That's what's in question. Not did we evolve, but exactly what was the mechanics behind it. That's the question.
And that's what makes it continuing. It's a vital area of scientific study. You know, and it's not just guys pulling out of their hats. I mean, if that's how people are doing it, then you're not doing science just by pulling ideas out of your hat. But for example, the genetic underpinnings of evolution are beyond dispute. I mean, we know that takes place. Check those websites out, and that's where you'll find some really good information and food for thought, and you can come back and hit us with more stuff later on. But we've got a lot of callers backed up, and we need to go on to the next guy. So we appreciate hearing from you.
Thanks, man.
And we hope to talk to you soon.
Thanks, Sean.
Charles is holding up the sign reminding us about God of the Gaps.
Yeah.
And, remember the new issue of Scientific American, which is out now. The July issue has responses to, what they call...
Creationist nonsense,
which to the creationist might seem like a kind of an insulting term, but really it does point out the difference between, you know, what science means by a theory and what non-scientific people think the word theory means. And they specifically address this question of, oh, well, evolution is actually just as much, it doesn't have any more evidence behind it than creation, so why shouldn't it? And they explain exactly kind of where it does and how it does.
Yeah. And actually, I'm reading right now the book, The Case for Faith, and that, the second chapter is all on miracles and stuff like that, and they go through that, you know, God of the Gaps extensively there.
Yeah.
We don't know exactly how the universe started. It must be God. So, and they have several things in there.
In case you're watching at home and you don't know what, first time you've ever heard of that term, that's God of the Gaps is the point of view when you don't, when science doesn't know the answer to something, you just plug in the word God to fill it in, and that supposedly handles the, you know, all questions that you might have. And that's just an, that's an improper way of establishing knowledge about various things. We're waiting for who our next caller is.
Okay,
well, we have Steve on three and Steve on three. Which Steve on three do you want me to take? I'm told that there's one and there's another. We'll just do the top one and see what else is going on. Hello, Steve?
Hey, hi.
Hi, you're on the air. Thanks for waiting.
Oh, no problem. I was just going to add my two cents real quickly.
Okay.
Sort of my perspective on agnosticism and atheism.
Okay.
Basically, in my opinion, everybody, I think, is an agnostic. I mean, even the Pope is. Basically, that's why they call it faith, right, rather than certainty. And so, therefore, you never have, I guess you could never have full certainty, nor could you have full non-certainty. So, in other words, everybody is an agnostic. Maybe there are those people that, you know, would consider themselves, you know, non-agnostics, in other words, full knowers, but we, you know, you pretty much discussed that, you know, ad nauseum. And then...
sorry, we get a little windbaggy here on the show. That's how we like to be...
Well, you know how it goes, right?
We like to be good and thorough.
No,
everyone to understand.
And I appreciate that.
Yeah.
But on the flip side, so it's basically a grayscale. Like, agnosia is a grayscale. I tend to be, you know, on towards the zero side, you know, of my grayscale of beliefs, but on the atheist side, I think it's basically a true or false. I mean, it's either or. You either believe in God or you do not believe in God. You know, and anyway, so that's basically my two cents.
That's interesting. Those are good points. Good points. I always say I am perfectly willing to believe any claim that is supported by solid, compelling evidence.
I will
change my mind in a heartbeat and become a theist if somebody provides hard, solid evidence to back up a theistic claim.
Exactly.
I was engaged in an email debate over the last couple of weeks with this Christian lady. This reiterates the point of extraordinary claims requiring extraordinary evidence, which was that she was writing me all concerned for my well-being and what have you. And doing her best to explain and try to, her religious beliefs to me and explain why that they were, she thought they were right and what have you. And I was hitting her with hardball questions, right? And I wasn't doing it to be a meanie, and I wasn't doing it to be, a bad guy. But, this is all in the interest of really, it was my attempt to demonstrate exactly what sort of hard questions need to be raised when you are being presented with a claim of this magnitude, an extraordinary claim, as opposed to an extraordinary claim. And she got flustered with me eventually and just claimed that, no, you're not listening to me, you're not listening to anything I'm saying. It's like, no, I am listening to you. The problem is you're giving me more or less the same canned explanations that I've heard many, many times. And what I was trying to point out to her was that she hadn't provided at any time in any of her emails to me actual evidence for her God. She was hitting me with a lot of emotional appeals, and she was engaging in this really interesting attempt to justify some of what, atheists consider to be the morally questionable content of, like, the Old Testament, which is, God killing everybody left and right and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I tried to point out, you're not getting it. So we really weren't communicating on the same plane in many ways. But I wasn't doing it to give her a hard time. I just had to say, look, this is the kind of quality scientifically that, for example, evolution or astronomical theories, like, back when whether or not the sun went around the earth or vice versa was a big question. Any sort of scientific question has to be ready to be put under major, major scrutiny before it's even taken remotely seriously by science. And And so I wasn't hitting her, and she kept trying to say, oh, well, you can't look at this in scientific means. And I said, why not? And so we went on this back and forth about it. But we appreciate hearing from you, and you raised a whole lot of good points, and feel free to call back anytime.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Take care.
Thanks.
So that's good. James is on a different James, apparently, than the one we're used to. We have a regular James, but this is a new James, and he's on line one. James?
Hi.
Hi. Thanks for waiting.
You know, I was just flipping through my stations on the channel here, and I just couldn't help but notice that you are you the Atheist Community of Austin? In other words, you don't believe in, God.
We don't believe in God. That's correct.
Okay. My next question is, have you ever read the Bible?
Yes, I have.
Okay. My next question is, did you specifically read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which is the Gospel of Jesus Christ?
Yes, I did.
Did you read John chapter 1, verse 1 then?
John chapter 1, verse 1? Well, I didn't memorize it, if you want me to. I mean, we have a Bible here.
The only reason I'm asking the question is, you know, what if you're wrong? What if you happen? What if you get on your deathbed? Let me finish. Mm-hmm. What if you get on your deathbed and you just, you know, what if I'm wrong? Okay. You got to give God a chance.
This is called,
you cut him off before he got a good start.
This is called Pascal's Wager, okay?
Okay.
What if you're wrong and can you afford to take the risk? What have you? We have to understand, there are a lot of problems with Pascal's, the whole argument behind Pascal's wager is that belief really ought to be this cost-benefit analysis thing where you look at, well, here are the options, here are the benefits of believing versus the benefits of not believing, and which is better, and then you should base how you make up your mind that way.
Well, I only ask you that, hold on for a second, okay? Yeah. I understand where you're going. Mm-hmm. What I'm trying to say is, I went and looked. I went and read the scriptures for myself, and I found him.
You found what?
I met the Lord.
You found what? Oh, you did.
You know what the Bible says?
Can you bring them on down someday?
Yeah, can. I mean,
you come to my church.
Which particular passage?
Say what?
Which particular passage was the one in which it introduced you to the Lord, specifically? Yeah. Oh, well, anyway, that's a deviation.
No,
okay.
No, you're doing just fine. You asked the perfect question.
Yeah, which?
The reason why I said, what you need to do is read John chapter 1, got me nervous, I'm excited and everything. John chapter
well, we
1,
have that effect on
verses
people.
1 through 14. Actually, what happens is I'm a reverend.
Let's read it right now.
Okay? Yeah, please do that.
Okay,
what Bible are you reading out of? Which one is it?
Oh, well, I don't
King
know.
King James?
It's New Revised Standard Version.
NRSV.
Okay, I was just bracing myself for what could happen.
Okay, now here's... if you hear big thunderclaps. Okay, here then, while we're looking this up, let me then talk to you about...
John, it's the fourth gospel.
Yes, I know.
Okay.
John 1:1, you said, right?
Okay.
Read 1 through 14 of chapter 1.
Okay, right. In the beginning was the Word, where was this God, et cetera, et cetera.
Don't read so fast, no.
And there was... okay, we're not...
It's a limited time.
We have a limited amount of time on calls.
Hold on, young man. Pardon me. If you're going to say there is no evidence for him, at least present the evidence, put it on the table so everybody can hear it.
Okay, you know what this is? This is a passage in a book that says that there's a guy called God and he did all this stuff. All right? Now, this is called a claim. The evidence is not the passage itself. The evidence would have to be what there is to back up this
passage. That Bible
just
said that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is God, and there is historical fact that Jesus Christ of Nazareth did walk this earth.
Well, that's an open question still, but the point is, words in a book aren't evidence of anything.
What about the actual historical fact that Jesus Christ of Nazareth did exist?
And what actual historical evidence would that be? Actual historical evidence would that be?
All you have to do is...
We have a Bible. What extra...
That's one historical fact.
What extra biblical evidence do you have for the existence of Christ?
Or non-biblical evidence,
That's what I mean. Like, evidence outside the Bible.
Yeah.
What exists...
You can read anyone that was alive 2,000 years ago, historian, and they'll be able to tell you. There was a man named Jesus
Christ.
Okay, name
one. Bring one up.
Name
one.
Okay, I'm not going to name one.
Well, okay then. Well, then we refrain from belief on the issue.
Let me explain something to you before we disconnect.
Wait, then we refrain from belief on the question until you present your evidence. There's nothing unreasonable about that.
You got a Bible sitting right in front of you.
We have a Bible.
And we've read it.
Several in the whole world.
Jack, I'm sorry. What's his name? You need to keep holding up the board for me.
My name is Reverend James.
James. You know, I could present to you Greek myths that talk about the doings of Zeus and Hera and Aphrodite, and all of those gods, okay? And the simple fact that these myths exist and they're written down in books talking about the actions of these gods are not alone and in and of themselves sufficient evidence for the existence of those gods.
All I'm saying to you, young man, is that there are scholars from his time period, okay?
And
that made mention of the note that he did exist and the things that he did do and say. They didn't take a stand neither pro or con, but they stated that he said these certain things, and these certain things did happen to him. He died on a cross, and then they went on to the next historical person.
Hey, that's great. Give me a reference, and I'll read it.
Wait a minute. I was just flipping through the channels when I saw you. I didn't go look in my library and pull up every name of every person.
Well, then good.
I just happened to find you at a whim.
Okay.
I was watching a basketball game, and then here you come.
That's right. Well, you know,
that's how most people find us.
Yes.
Yeah, what I'm trying to get you to see is this. There is more evidence in the Holy Scriptures of the Holy Bible that Jesus Christ did exist.
Jack.
And it's the most accurate historical piece of literature written from that time period that you'll ever find. Even more accurate than Homer's Iliad and the Odyssey.
Okay. And how do we know?
I'm challenging you for a second, okay? And the reason why
let me respond to that point, though. Okay, you say that the Scriptures are the most accurate historical record of that time period.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, now then.
Call any seminary and they'll tell you the same thing.
Wait, not done. Okay, then explain to me the four contradictory resurrections accounts. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Each gospel talks about Jesus' resurrection. Each gospel tells a different account of how the resurrection transpired. They can't all be right, so which one is accurate?
Okay. I'm saying there's what they call synoptic or chronological gospels, okay?
Okay.
And if you take your hand on your left hand, hold your left hand up, and then you take your right hand and you hold it up, and then you fold those fingers together, then that's kind of the way it works. But I don't really.
So you're saying you put them all together.
What happened was there were four different men, and one of them saw. He wrote what he saw.
Uh-huh.
Then the third one wrote what he saw. The second one wrote what he saw, and the third one wrote what he saw.
So you're saying four men witnessed the same event.
Can I be a witness?
I'm trying to clarify a point.
Forget what they said, because you're going to argue with me about something that 2,000 years ago.
James, you just claimed that the Bible was the most historically accurate text there is of this time period. I've pointed out one story with four different accounts of how it transpired. They can't all be accurate. Four different accounts of the same event can't all be true.
If you study the Scriptures, if you give it a chance.
Jack, do you know what the four different accounts of the resurrection are?
Calm down a little bit. My name is James.
James, I'm sorry. I'm trying to pin you down on this question. I'm sorry. I need to get an answer from you. Do you know what the four different accounts of the resurrection are? How they go?
Well, I get a feeling you're getting ready to tell me.
Very good.
I want to hear this.
Either there's one angel or there's two angels. Either Mary shows up alone at the temple, or she has one woman with her, or she has two women with her. In one, she has, I think, 11 women with her. Either the angels are inside the temple, either they're outside. Either the temple is closed when Mary shows up, or the angel shows up and rolls it away in front of her.
How did you consider God, you know?
Hold on.
Out of all the people to go doubt, you might want to go doubt 50 million other people before you doubt this one particular individual. Give him a chance to prove himself. He says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. He said, in order for you to discover God, you have to believe that he exists, first of all.
Well, you know, no.
Oh, yes, it does. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1.
Well, you could apply that argument to anything. If I wanted to believe in leprechauns, I would first have to believe that they exist before I'm willing to accept the notion of leprechaun up there
at Notre Dame, that Catholic Church. They'd love to talk to you.
Bring them on, dude.
Oh,
we are giving every theist a chance.
Let me tell you something. We can play around, horse around, right, with, you know, mention words if we want to. But I'm telling you something. I have already met this dude. I've already met him.
Great. Bring him
down to the studio. We really, really want to meet him.
Did you know that?
No, I.
God is a spirit. He's a spirit, brother.
I have been trying to pin you down.
And if there's no spirit to meet God's spirit, you have to pray and read his word, or else you'll never meet him.
Okay, so then you admit you have no evidence. It's all based upon evidence.
It's called a testimony. I wouldn't have called you if I hadn't met him.
Uh-huh, and there are 2,000 active religions in the world. They all have their testimonies.
The devil is a deceiver.
Explain to me why any of them is trying
to keep you from getting to Jesus Christ.
If there's a God and there's a devil, who's to say you're not influenced by the devil? If you walk through a mental ward, a lot of the people there believe things just as fervently as you do.
Yeah, Andrea Yates believed she was sending her babies to heaven when she drowned them in the bathtub.
You don't see me killing any babies, do you?
No, I don't. But,
do you see me
but the point is, how can one tell,
drinking blood or anything else like
without
that?
Solid evidence, how can you have good evidence, how can you have any justification to say, A,
the Bible
this being
says
exists,
that the just shall live by faith.
Yes, well.
Adam and Eve fell in the garden because they didn't have faith in God's word, that if they ate from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that they would die.
Uh-huh.
And God said, I tell you what, mm-hmm. He said, the just shall live by faith. And you automatically cut yourself off when you do not show faith toward God.
Wait a minute.
You got
to draw close to God for
Him to draw close to you.
If God was speaking to them directly, what did they need faith for? They had positive proof, direct proof that this being existed.
Wait a minute, man. He said, if you do anything other than what I just told you,
right, so they didn't need faith there. They had this being directly speaking to them,
they
saying, don't do this.
Word because they
where does faith
it?
Have any relevance at that point? You don't need faith when you have direct proof. I'm asking you to provide the definite proof of your claims.
The definite proof of my claim is in that book sitting right around your left shoulder there, or
it's
right, left hand.
It's a book.
It's simple, okay.
Read the word. It's like directions. You
We've
directions
read it. We have
party?
Read it, and I have pointed out.
Has anyone ever given you directions to a party?
I have, okay, that's not the same thing.
If you follow the directions, you'll get to the party.
The difference
is, but if you
don't
follow the directions, what's going to happen?
The difference is, I can look in a map book, which is a book, granted, but then I can go out on the streets and say, wow, this matches up. I can't do that with this book. Yeah. I can't
spirit,
go to this book
heart,
and find actual
does
evidence.
Does your spirit and your heart or your soul have any type of appreciation or understanding that there is a higher being?
Do you have any appreciation of
no.
the fact that I just pointed out four direct contradictions in this biblical text that you claim is the most perfect historical account
now
that exists, and you haven't addressed it? So explain to me that if this Bible you claim is the perfect historical record has direct contradictory information about an event, and that's not just the only event, that's the simple example that I gave for the purpose of this argument.
I dare you to read that Bible from cover to cover and ask God whether or not He exists. He'll
Why should I ask God anything?
I
don't believe in this being. I don't ask beings I don't believe in to show me things. You need to provide the evidence for the existence of this being before I have any reason to ask it anything. I'm trying to point out that this is the book you're claiming is the sole and only evidence that's necessary for belief in this God.
Oh, yeah.
And I can point out to you that there are contradictory passages that create reasonable doubt. Okay? In a court of law, if a jury has reasonable doubt,
they have to. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help me God.
I didn't have to say that when I did jury duty because we had a respectful situation going on there.
Oh,
but,
really?
But the point is, if there is reasonable doubt, then you have to say, there's reasonable doubt, and I can't agree with this claim that's being made. And when you can point to direct...
The evidence gets provided. The evidence for you to meet God, it all comes when you exist faith toward God.
James, explain to me then why there are any contradictions at all in your perfect text.
I don't see any contradictions.
So I just pointed them out to
you.
Then
you haven't read it.
Then we seem to know more about its contents than you do. Because
no, that's
I pointed
not true.
Out... I pointed out that each
you,
of the four Gospels...
You just took God and took Him all the way out of the equation because you're thinking too hard. You didn't even give Him a chance.
Well, wait, we're thinking too hard? Gee whiz.
You think so much, you end up losing your soul,
So if you think, then religion goes poof, and the house of cards comes down. Isn't that what you're saying?
All I said was that you have to...
Gee, we're thinking too hard. Well,
the Holy Bible has already given
so
you.
So if all we have to do is not think, and then all of this stuff will make perfect sense to us.
But it seems like there's a prejudice that you have toward God for some strange reason.
Look, there are four Gospels, four different accounts of the resurrection.
They're called the Synoptic Gospels.
They
harmonize, brother.
They don't harmonize, and I will read to you how they don't, if you want.
You better read that again. It looks like to me you didn't really read it for understanding. You kind of browsed through it.
No, I will tell you exactly what happens. In Matthew, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of Jesus show up at the tomb. The tomb is closed. One angel turns up, rolls away the tomb. They see the tomb is empty. Okay? Mark, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, and one other woman show up.
Mm-hmm.
The tomb is already opened. The angel is sitting there waiting beside the temple. Beside the tomb, sitting there waiting for them to turn up, and the angel informs them Jesus has been raised. Mark, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of Jesus show up. They are in a group of 11 women. The tomb is open already, and there are two angels present. who inform all the women that Jesus has been raised. John, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb alone. The tomb is open. She doesn't see anyone around. She runs and she goes and gets a couple of Jesus' disciples. They check the place out. The disciples then leave, and then Mary turns, looks in the tomb, and sees the angels inside the tomb, where they then inform her Jesus has risen. Mm-hmm. Four different accounts of the same event. They can't all be true. Which one's right?
Okay.
There can't be two angels and only one angel at the same time.
Okay.
There can't be only two women and 11 women at the same time.
I don't mean to keep addressing you as young man. Give me your name again.
My name's Martin. It's right there on the bottom of the screen.
Martin.
Okay, see, I'm trying to say to you
that in all the controversy that you that surrounds Jesus Christ of Nazareth, mm-hmm. who claimed to be God, I can only tell you what I found, okay?
Look.
And that is this. I'm sorry for exciting you there on your program.
Hey, no, we live for this stuff.
This is what we're here for.
We love doing this. And we're not trying to, this isn't personal, all right? We're not trying to smack you around and be mean to you.
Yeah, I don't know. You got me a little excited when I saw you on the television there. I was going, what?
Okay.
I'm just saying, you know, make you think.
Make you think.
Every human being owes it to himself to read the Holy Bible at least once. And you need to pray as you read it for God to give you understanding.
I'm not going to pray.
Do you believe that you have a soul?
No, I do not.
Nope.
You don't believe you have a soul?
There's no evidence that points to that there are spooky souls inside
the body. Do you believe that you have a spirit?
I do not. I have no evidence for that.
Depends on your definition of it, but probably not.
What is a spirit? How do you detect it? Where does it reside?
The Bible says in Genesis that God breathed into Adam's nostril, he became a living soul.
Okay, now where's the medical evidence to back that up? Have you ever seen a spirit on a CAT scan? Have you ever seen one on an X-ray? Have you ever seen one on an MRI? Have you ever...
I trust the authority of the scriptures to guide me on spiritual things.
Okay, well, the thing is, see, here's the difference. You know, we don't see any reason to simply take those scriptures as absolute authority without evidence to back it up. Okay, we don't see any reason to do that.
Hold on for a second. The way you get the evidence when you read the scriptures is by obeying God's word. And then from there, God will...
We don't believe this being exists. We can't obey the word of a being that we don't believe exists. We need to have evidence that the being exists. Then we need to be given reason to think that this being's word is a thing that we must automatically obey. Mm-hmm. Then we'll deal with that issue. So let's talk about the question of existence first, and then we'll move on to the next thing.
The Bible is a spiritual book, my friend. And the Bible says that...
Even if we contend...
Looks like it's paper and cardboard to me. I mean, see?
Even if we contend that this...
He did pretty good for a spirit, didn't he? Because he put his word where you could reach it.
And evidently not, because it would seem to me that an omniscient, all-powerful being would write a book that did not have any contradictions, errors, or mistakes in it. And I just pointed one out. So, anyway, look. We appreciate that you channel surfed...
You might not pray, but I am going to pray for you, because look, I've already met him.
Good for you. Right. Well, if you can convince him to come on down to the studio, we deeply want to meet the guy.
Why don't we do a halfway point?
Why don't we do a halfway point? You come halfway, he comes halfway. Will you do that?
We don't have any obligation to come halfway.
Wait a minute. You just got finished asking me that if I asked him to come to you, you talk to him, right?
You're the one making the claim that a God exists.
A halfway point for you guys to meet. Will you
go? Okay, we're meeting you halfway right now. We have this show. We accept calls.
I'm asking you to go to St. Austin's Catholic Church. That's a meeting place.
Excuse me?
That's a meeting place.
I was raised.
Now you're raised.
Wait a second.
And you'll meet him halfway. The halfway point you can meet him at is at St. Austin's Catholic Church. That's fair.
Okay, you got a good advertising plug.
You meet him halfway.
You got a good advertising plug in your church. So then what you're saying is the church that I was actually raised in, which was
a
Baptist.
I didn't say anything about your church. You just got finished telling me that if I arrange for you to meet him at a halfway point, you go there and meet him.
Wait a minute. This being is supposed to be all powerful. Why is it necessary that you have to go to some specific building?
Okay, wait a minute. Okay, that's even better. Don't even leave that seat that you're sitting in right now. You can meet him right there.
All right.
Read some scriptures. I guarantee you that you'll meet him.
I bet we won't.
I just read through your scriptures, and I pointed out an inconsistency, okay?
You know what? I didn't prepare myself when it came down to doing this. I just happened to see you at a glance.
Right.
And I said, well, you know what? I could call them and talk to them, part of me said, no, nah, just let them, you know.
Hey, we appreciate hearing your call.
Something had me pick up the phone and call you.
Okay, but we are in our last 45 seconds now, so we're about to go off the air. We appreciate hearing from you.
Thanks for calling.
Hey, call
it. The fool said in his heart there is no God, my man.
Well, the Bible also said what I said about four different accounts of the same event, so I see no reason to accept it as authoritative text.
Well, I hope you work this out before you die.
That's right. And, of course, Christianity, when it doesn't have evidence, resorts to threats.
And if you ever do find this guy, run away.
Because he kills lots and lots
of people. Run away.
Okay. I love that. Ashley, I guess we just think too hard on this show. That's our problem.
Yeah, we'll have to knock that off.
Darn
that nasty habit.
Darn that thinking stuff, you know? It just kind of gets in the way of that faith thing.
Yeah.
Hey, Christians, we don't hate you. We just think you're wrong. We'll hear next week, 4:30. See you then.